Hey everyone, it's Derek with Nerd or Die, and in this video, I'm going to show you how to use filters to modify your sources inside of OBS Studio. This will allow you to do things like cropping, green screen effects, and even delay different sources. Let's get right into it. The first thing I'm going to do is add two sources into my scene. First, I'm going to add an animated background to the scene, and then I'm going to add a simulated webcam as well. The webcam simulation will actually just be a media source that's a video on loop, but you should get the idea of how to apply filters to this source from what I'm going to do here. Now, the thing that you need to realize about filters is that they can be added to every source individually. However, if you apply filters to a source in one scene, they will carry over to any other scenes that you use this source in. So this basically means that if you want to have two different filters applied to the same source, you'd have to add that type of source in again and then rename it something different, such as image 2 or webcam 2. We'll get into that more in the future in a video about setting up our scenes. Now, another thing I want to quickly mention is that there are two types of filters: audio/video filters and effect filters. We're going to actually start this video by going through each of the effect filters first. To use a filter, let's first click the source that we want to apply it to, and then right-click on it and select Filters. If our source allows audio and video filters, there'll be a section for them up here at the top on the left. But again, let's look at the effect filters first. They'll be here at the bottom left. We can see our selected source on the right side of this property menu. Now, we can just hit the plus to add a filter to our source. Let's go ahead and work our way from the top down. The first thing that we're going to start with is the image mask blend, but let's go ahead and notice that applying filters is pretty similar to adding new sources into OBS. For image mask blend, we can just select it, name the filter, and then hit OK. Filters have the ability to be toggled on and off just like sources. All you need to click is the eye icon. Image mask blend might seem a little bit complicated as a new streamer. Let's take it slow and then you'll be able to understand what uses you can have for this filter. You'll first be able to select what type of mask or blend you would like to use. Path gives you the option and the ability to select a file to add as a mask or a blend. Color, you'll generally want to leave on its default, at least for this filter. Opacity can go from 0 to 100, where if you lower it from its default of 100, it will become more and more see-through. Stretch image, discard aspect ratio, will actually take your image that you selected to use as a mask or blend and fit it to the entire source. Alright, so what does this all mean? Let's say you want to put your webcam in a circle or some sort of shape. You can use a mask to hide certain areas of your webcam or any source. To do this, let's use a black and white image as an example. I'll open the image for you to first see. You should notice that around the edges of the image is black and in the middle is a white circle. If I select this image as my path file, then select Alpha Mask Color Channel, you'll see that my webcam will now have the black areas hidden. The easiest way to remember how masks work is that black hides and white reveals. Grays will actually cause transparency depending on how bright or dark they are. Also, if I check Stretch Image, you'll see that the circle is stretched so that my filter image is stretched across my entire source, disregarding its aspect ratio. You can also use filters as blends, meaning that you can take advantage of multiply, addition, and subtraction blends. If you're familiar with Photoshop layer blends, this achieves the same sort of effect as that. If not, don't worry too much about this, as it isn't something that's extremely important to get into streaming. I'm going to go ahead and just remove this filter by selecting it and hitting the minus button. Now, let's talk about the crop filter. Let's add it just like we did the image mask blend filter, and we'll see a familiar setup. Leave relative checkmarked, and let's pretend that our webcam has a bit too much showing on the left side and on the top. We can use the arrows here on the right to slowly adjust the amount to crop by simply clicking and holding. If we start with the left, we'll notice that the left side is being removed from our source. Now we can just simply manually type in an amount, which is in pixels, to remove that amount as well. After I get the left side cropped exactly where I want it to be, I'm going to move on to the top area and type in an amount that I'd like to crop out. Let's actually close the filters panel and take a look at what happened in the final result. With my webcam cropped how I like it, I can move it anywhere on my screen now. I just simply click and drag it where I want. If I need to make more adjustments to this filter, I can just right-click the source and hit filters to bring back up the filters panel. Next, let's talk about color correction. We're going to apply this filter to my background video. After I open up the filters panel, I'll add a color correction filter. The first thing we'll notice is color. This basically will tint the source the color that we select. So I can choose red, for example, and we'll see the effects that it applies. If I don't like this effect, I can change it back to the default by using white. The sliders provide you the ability to adjust contrast, brightness, and gamma for your source. These can be useful to adjust webcam settings or even potentially some media or games that you feel might show up too dark, or perhaps you just want them a different color. Getting into the differences of each of these can be a little bit confusing, so we won't be covering that in this tutorial. However, you can always play around with these options and get something that works great for you. Now, let's talk about the scroll filter. This can actually be used in some interesting ways. First, it's very useful to make text sources move from left to right or vice versa. Next, let's say you have a repeatable pattern or maybe a static image that you just want to move a bit. You can use it to scroll and make it move horizontally or vertically across the screen. To do so, let's just adjust the sliders with the speed of each direction you'd like to have it to move. OBS will automatically make the source repeat itself. Scroll also includes the ability to limit the width and height of the source. This works a little bit similarly to cropping, but I've actually found myself using both limit width, height, and crop together. Let's go ahead and move on to another filter, the color key, but let's actually talk about chroma key as well. So you might have tried these out yourself and you may be wondering, what's the difference? Well, I'm going to try to make it as simple as possible for you. If you want to filter out or hide a green screen, use chroma key. From what I've read and what I've seen before, chroma key is what more streamers will want to use. A color key can be more useful with graphics that have a specific color you'd like removed. Anyways, I'm going to add a filter to the green screen example and show you what my settings do inside of this filter. Let's work with the chroma key here. We can then go ahead and use our preset colors under key color type, or we can actually choose our own color. For green screens, this is generally the best idea. You want to select the closest color to your screen possible. So with custom color selected, let's hit select color. Here we can select our color in various ways. We can actually use the pick screen color option to pull up a sort of eyedropper that will let us match the color we're hovering over. Go to your source and select the most common color shade you see in it. That way you can actually key out this color. Simply just click it here and it will add in the color that you need. You can then hit add to custom colors to save this color selection. Then just hit OK. If you're using a green screen, you might already see some good results. If not, don't worry, we can do a little bit of tweaking here in the options. First, if you plan on using a green screen, I can't recommend anything better than proper lighting. Having more consistent of a color is what will produce the best results. Ideally, the entire screen is the exact same color and shade, but in reality, I realize that isn't possible for most of us. So let's talk about what each option does. First, we have similarity. This means how close to our selected color we'd like to filter out. Where one is the exact color, and increasing it from there increases the range of colors to key out that are close to the selected color. Next is smoothness. If you slide this input around, you should be able to kind of tell what's happening. It's basically blending out the colors that are around the color that we're keying out. So if you're having trouble keying out areas where the color that you'd like to remove is meeting the colors that you'd like to keep, smoothness might actually help you out just a bit. Usually around things like edges, it cleans them up a little bit. Basically, it turns the colors around what we're keying out into transparent values. So in essence, it smooths out these areas. Finally, we have key color spill reduction. This option is for those of you that might experience a spill of key color. It's possible that you might see some green tint reflected on certain areas in your source, or maybe some of the color is showing between hairs or some sort of fabric. Increasing this value will help these types of issues. Color spill is sometimes tricky to remove, but use your best judgment. Again, I do want to reiterate how important it is to use proper lighting if you have a green screen. In my opinion, you'd be better off buying a cheap piece of green fabric and investing in some lighting to make sure colors are as even as possible. All right, now next, let's go ahead and move on to sharpen. This is actually the easiest filter to understand. If you have a blurry image, webcam, or a similar source that you just want to kind of sharpen up, just simply increase the sharpness to the desired effect. Be careful with sharpness though. It can make things look a bit unnatural if you use too much. So again, play around with it and figure out which value works for you. Now, as I mentioned at the start, there are filters that only are allowed for certain sources. Let's go through them one by one, just pretty quickly. The first is gain, and these again are part of the audio and video filters. Put simply, gain will increase or decrease the volume of a source. So if your sound is too low, you can just increase the gain to compensate. It would be best if you can increase the volume through the source itself somehow, but if you have to, gain can be very useful. Next is video delay async. This basically will tell a specific source to be delayed a certain amount of time in milliseconds. So let's say you have a capture card such as an Elgato. That has a built-in delay of about 1 second or maybe even a little bit more. You could add 1000 milliseconds to delay your cam by 1 second to ensure that your reactions are matched with what's happening in your game capture. Personally, I use this option to match my webcam with my microphone as I run my audio through Adobe Audition to clean it up a bit. My audio is technically delayed by 250 milliseconds so that it has enough time to kind of process it. So basically, I add a 250 millisecond delay to my webcam to match what's happening with my voice and my audio so that everything looks correct. Now, the last filter is noise gate. You may be already familiar with these options, but let's take a look. If you have a source that you'd like to automatically filter out some loud noises or only noises that can play above a certain level, then you want to set up a noise gate filter. Close threshold represents the amount of decibels that you need to have coming from the source in order to play some noise, or close this gate if the audio is too low. Open threshold is the decibels that the audio will need to be at so that it can play through the source, or open the gate at this volume. So you'll notice that you could have the audio in between open and close. This simply means that you can open the gate once you hit a certain level, but it won't close unless it falls below this other audio level. So this is where our other options come in. Attack time is how long it will take the source to play the audio after the gate is breached. So you'll generally want this time pretty low. Hold time is how long after the gate has been opened to play an audio from the source, regardless of the decibel level. This time will be reset each time that the source has audio that is loud enough to breach the gate. Release time will lower the volume over the time that it has cut out. This helps remove abrupt cuts from the audio, which makes it seem a bit more natural. Alright guys, so if you stuck with me this entire video, you should now basically be a master of filters. Again, there's something that I think people look over and dismiss when they start streaming, but knowing them well can really make a huge difference in your stream setup. If you like this video, make sure to give it a like, and if you have any questions about filters, put them in the comments below and let me know what you'd like to know about them. Also, make sure to subscribe to Nerd or Die for more great streaming and video game related content. Thanks for watching.